can't believe there's going to be so many innuendos in this one show.
This show is tailor-made for you and I.
I feel the call from Human Resources is coming in Monday morning. But there's help at hand, and not from us.
This is the show about twiddling your knob. Make sure to stay to the end to hear our 4-point plan for how to maximize your image.
Hi, I'm Stuart.
And I'm Jeff.
And welcome to Walk Around the Block.
And today is the Two Knobs episode. No, not...
Some people think every episode is the Two Knobs episode, Jeff.
Yes, but this episode we're going to talk about the knobs on the ultrasound machine that you may not know are there. Or the ones that you may not know how to control and how to get a good picture. And stay tuned to the end, where we'll show you our plan for how to make your picture the best it possibly can be.
Yeah, and I think there's a story of two knobs that people know about and two knobs that they don't.
Yeah, I agree.
Back to us again.
So I think even the most novice sonographer will know about depth. That's the first thing they'll be comfortable using. Agree?
Yep.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Yeah. And the other one I think is gain.
Yeah.
The brightness.
Yeah.
Kind of just like the brightness on your TV. And I think, of course, it says it's got to be deep enough to see everything, but I usually start with the depth fairly deep. I kind of like the John Ford Western, Monument Valley, and he gets the wide panorama, and then he zooms in, and John Wayne and the horse. Well, soldier. Okay. So I like to have the depth deep initially, and then I'll often tighten it up to when I know where my target is.
Yeah, that's a good approach. I like that. As opposed to starting out too shallow and think, oh, no, I have to go deeper. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
You're a deep guys too.
Yeah. Thinker.
Deep thinker. Yeah. And then the gain. I mean, the gain is always a playing around with it kind of thing, right? It's hard. Some machines have an auto gain where you can hit a button and it'll just predict the right amount of brightness and contrast for you. But I think in most cases, it's a bit of trying to figure out what the right
tuning the radio.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So and it's a Goldilocks thing. So you can have too much, too little, and just right. So once you have those two things under control and your image looks reasonable, mm-hmm. that's when these other knobs come into play.
Yeah, and often in challenging patients where they're just not a good ultrasound subject, or you know, you're really challenged by marked depth, that's when the other buttons come into play. Sometimes you just put the probe on and the image is...
It's a glorious day.
It's a good day at the office.
Yeah.
But then there are patients that are challenging, and this is when the other buttons and understanding your ultrasound machine is really important. And the ones that people tend to not use as much, and if I ask them, teaching beginners... I'll ask them, you know, okay, show me, how do you adjust the frequency on your ultrasound machine?
Right. Not always easy
no,
to find on the machine.
No, yeah. No, because some machines don't actually have a number. We think a frequency range from, the probe might say, from 5 hertz to 15 hertz, and then you look on the machine and there isn't anything with a frequency number marked on it.
Or the numbers, yeah.
And a lot of the machines will use res or resolution or pen for penetration, but they won't actually be a frequency number.
Right.
So the most common one, I don't want to name company names, but they'll use res, gen, and pen. Res for resolution, the highest frequencies, pen for penetration, the lowest, and gen in the middle.
Yeah.
And the important thing for beginners is if you've got a linear probe, a high frequency probe, res will be 15 megahertz. But if you've got a curvilinear probe, a low frequency probe, it'll still have a res on that, but that resolution will only be 5 megahertz.
Right.
So it'll change based on the probe.
Right. So they've bundled that range into three sort of levels. So on the high frequency probe, the res will be the top third of that range, and the bottom third for the pen. Yeah, that's a good point.
What about focus?
Squirrel. The focus is that's one. I think that's the one that I see people not using to its best advantage most. Mm-hmm. And I see people, the focus will be inadvertently set to the very top of the screen from the previous user, and we're trying to look for an adductor canal. It's, you know, 3 or 4 centimeters deep, and it's just a bit of a hazy image. And it all it takes is a matter of turning that focus down so that now the beam, the focus, the beam is actually a little bit shaped like an hourglass, and that little waist area is where the beam is.
Kind of like my waist. Like,
yeah. That's right. Mm-hmm. Is where the focus concentrates that beam, so you get the highest resolution right there. So you make use of that focus, and oftentimes you can split that focus from one layer into two and have a zone of focus where it's the most resolution.
So some of the high-end machines will let you have multiple focus zones, but yeah. Most people, when they start, and most departments, will have a simple and easy to use machine. And you can search through all the fields and all the buttons, and there'll be no focus on it. So these machines work on the principle that the center of the screen is the focus. So if you have the depth set to 2 centimeters, the focus will be around 1 centimeter. If you have the depth set to maximum, that might be 6 centimeters, the focus will be 3 centimeters. It means that when you get beyond 4 to 5 or 6 centimeters, yes, you can make the depth go to 6 centimeters, but that lower third of the screen will probably not be in focus. So then you get a probe, the depth will go to 6 centimeters with these machines. You'll find that the focal area won't be very good in the lower part of the screen. This picture will get grainy, and you won't be able to discriminate structures as well. So that's important to understand, that if there is no focus button, you've probably got a fixed focus control, and that is going to give you a poorer picture quality more than likely. And more commonly with older machines, the distal part of that picture is going to be grainy.
Yeah. So use your depth in that case to put your target right in the center of the screen from a up to down perspective, and then that's where the focus will be.
Now, if you're not sure about the equipment you have, when your hospital purchases it, there will be support for the ultrasound machine.
Yep, just call Stu. He'll help you.
Yeah, after midnight,
anytime.
Yeah. So you will have an ultrasound application specialist. They'll serve your hospital, and they're waiting at the end of the phone for you. They're only too happy if you don't call, because they've usually got a great tan and a golf handicap of 2, because nobody calls them. So please give them a call, and they'll come out and actually go through all the range of controls and help you utilize the machine better.
That's right. And that's the thing. They're only too happy to teach us, I find.
Yeah.
And they're 9 times out of 10, you know, sonographers from back in the day that have gone on to work in industry, and they know the principles of ultrasound way better.
They've actually trained in that?
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Wow. What a concept.
Yeah. So
if you're going to take somebody and here's the kicker. Take me through the four controls. What's your plan for teaching somebody at the start? All right.
So here it is. Walk around the blocks plan for how to get the best image using your machine. Number one, set the depth. All right.
Number two, adjust the gain.
Number three, adjust your frequency to match the type of structures you're looking to find.
And number four, adjust the focus. Do you have adjustable focus? Do you need to make sure your structure's in the middle of the screen? And to do that, it might mean dropping the linear probe and plugging in the low frequency probe to get that structure in the center. You'll be amazed that even though you drop the frequency, when you put that structure in the middle, the image will look much better.
So there you go. A 4-point plan from Jeff and Stu.
Yeah. 1, 2, 3, 4. So knobs you know, knobs you don't. Thanks for listening.
See you next time.
See you next time.